Good morning and welcome. Public, distinguished guests, involved people. This is an auspicious occasion. This is the biggest event, probably, that Knoebels has ever tackled. In moving a roller coaster from Texas was one, but this is another big one. And I have to do it all, give credit to the fourth generation. And I'd like to introduce the family here in a moment. My brother, Ron. And my sister, I guess, isn't here. And the members of the fourth generation are here. My sons, Rick and Brian. And my brother's son, Trevor. I'm old school. So the new people coming up in the family organization have elected to take this project and run with it. And I have done that too. So you may see them with shovels shortly, but I brought my instrument, a pen, because I'm the guy that has to sign the checks. So, buddy?
Good morning and welcome to this event. On this day, I'm reminded a little bit of a story. Quite a few years ago, there was a fellow here, and many of you probably know him, Foster Furman. And he was with myself and Dick and my son Trevor, and he referred to Trevor as a two percenter. And I said, what's a two percenter? And he went on, and I'm not going to tell the whole story, but he went on to say that basically family businesses, only 2% ever make it to the fourth generation. So you're looking at 3 2 percenters here behind me. There's two others who are not here. Niece Lauren and my daughter Stacy, who's currently being a full-time mother. So we are blessed. This family is blessed that we have this fourth generation to come on to carry on this tradition. We're also blessed by a fantastic staff who have been able to keep this business running. It is certainly not just Knoebels, people with the last name of Knoebels, who make this place work. We have a tremendous staff and a great support team. So I'd like to thank all of those people for all that they have to bring us to today. As Dick said, this is really the fourth generation's project, so you're not going to hear any much more from me anyway. So I will turn it over to them. And I believe Brian is the first to speak.
Good morning. Let me move this down to my height. So as a family, we discuss our needs, our wants, and our guests' needs and wants. Our guests have continued to ask for an exciting steel roller coaster to complement our two wooden coasters, the Phoenix and the Twister. We dismantled our previous steel roller coaster called the Whirlwind in 2004, sold it to an amusement park in Costa Rica, and begun constructing the world's only flying turns shortly thereafter. 10 years have gone by, and we felt it was time to begin shopping for something in this very location. The bumper boats have been a wonderful piece for us, and with the addition of the boat tag ride, complemented the bumper boats very well. Over time, both rides have declined in ridership, and we knew we had to install something so our guests would continue to make Knoebels a family destination. God has blessed our business, and the Knoebel family is honored to announce Impulse, a thrilling custom steel coaster. We're going to roll you, we're going to twist you, and we're going to turn you upside down. This is a very exciting time for Knoebels. Over the past few years, we took a few trips to various amusement parks, business conventions. We did a lot of studying, dissecting, and challenging one another to what is the perfect fit for Knoebels. What does Knoebels need to not change the face, that wouldn't change the face of what Knoebels truly is? Not only do we feel confident that we have chosen wisely, but the time spent with my brother and my cousin has been very rewarding. Our generation promises to keep Knoebels that special place for families to make memories together for many years to come. Thank you for coming.
We heard my brother talk a little bit about how we got to that decision. I'll tell you a little bit about the ride. It's going to be really, really thrilling. It's going to be over 2,000 feet of track that's going to twist you and turn you. We're going to start off going up a 90-degree incline. It gets up to 98 feet, where it suddenly drops 90 degrees straight down. It's going to go into what's called a cobra roll, which will turn you upside down twice, and then up through another loop. It'll go from there around and an overbank turn over the station, make a turn around the tower, which we call the top hat, and then it'll do a heartline roll right through the center of that loop that I talked about earlier. And from there, it'll make an upward helix and back into the station. It's going to hit speeds of around 55 miles an hour, and it should be just over a minute to ride. We really don't know the speed at this point. We're, you know, it's what the simulations had showed us. But it's going to be a heck of a ride. The cars that you're going to sit in are pretty unique. It's not a coaster train like most of you are used to, but they're going to be single cars. There's going to be 8 people per car. There'll be 3 cars. And there'll be 2 rows of 4. And instead of an over-the-shoulder restraint system, it's just going to be a lap bar, or should I say kind of a thigh bar. It comes over across the entire lap very comfortably, and also has a little bit of an ankle restraint as well. You're not encased into like a car so much. You're pretty much wide open. There's no sides on this. There's really no front to it. And it's going to be, it puts you right into the action. Also, the cars have stadium seating, so everybody gets a fantastic view as they're going through all these inversions and turns. How we came up with the name Impulse? Well, it took us a long time to get there. We started off with about 10 names, and we grew to about 70 names at some point. We formed a little focus group of some of our staff here, and they came up with some fantastic names. And we had to slim it down and you know, get it further down until we kind of came across with Impulse. It was hanging around the top 5, say. And it's because we, you know, it was an impulse for us to get one, but also we hope that it's going to be impulsive for people to ride. So, Trevor's going to talk to you a little bit more about the ride.
Good morning. So I'm going to talk a little bit about from here forward. Where are we going from today moving on to the completion of this project? First, I would like to mention that we have awarded this project to Bill Anska's company of Paxinus. They will carry out the role of general contractor for the installation of the foundations and the erection of the steel ride itself. They have shown us that they are ready to take on this momentous project for Knoebels, and we are confident that they can complete the task. Bill Anska's company is set to start mobilizing this week. Plans are to begin drilling and installing the foundations before the end of October. They are set to have the foundations complete near the end of January. Immediately following, they're going to roll into phase 2 of the project with the steel erection and assembly of the coaster. At that point, there will be a team here from Zierer, the coaster manufacturer, that to help guide and direct the assembly of the coaster. From there, Zierer will then take us through the commissioning of the ride, which includes training our maintenance and operational staff, as well as testing of the ride. This is all set to be complete for opening day of 2015. Approximately 40 steel containers are due to start arriving from Germany in mid-December and through mid-January. As these containers arrive, our in-house maintenance staff will have the task of unloading, inventorying, and documenting where each piece is staged. The entire project will be a very collective effort between Bill Anska's company, their subcontractors, and our Knoebels in-house staff. like to thank our staff from the office staff to the maintenance staff to our art department to the focus group that Rick mentioned earlier in choosing the name. Everyone who has had an involvement or a part of this project has certainly made it possible. As of lately, it was so impressive to see so many of our staff jump in and prepare the site alongside with Sokol Excavating. This site was completely transformed from the bumper boat tag site that it previously was into what you see standing behind us here, ready for the beginning of construction. As we continue to prepare the infrastructures for this exciting addition to Knoebels, it has been wonderful to see the enthusiasm and cooperation of everyone. The three of us, Brian, Rick, myself, collectively want to really stop and thank our dads, Dick, Buddy, or our aunt, Leanna, who's not with us here today, for their guidance, their faith, trust in our generation, to allow us to embark on such a huge investment for the future of this company, a company that means so much to so many people, the people who work here, the people who play here, and the people who pass traditions down here. Thank you from all of us. Thank you for that trust. Of course, they provide us with terrific guidance, great guidance. Jim Martini, who is on our staff, has been involved from day one with this project. He's been involved every step of the way. John Fetterman has been a huge help in the plot planning and coming up with the proper elevations so that we know the ride is safe from flooding and other issues. When we got into the bidding process, this was something very new to us, something we've never done before. Blair Faust from our lumber company was very instrumental in helping us through the bidding process. So we've had a lot of fantastic help along the way. We want to make a special thank you to our local officials from Cleveland and Franklin Townships who have been cooperative and supportive of Knoebels and this project. Finally, we must point out how wonderful it has been working with so many different parties that are involved. Zierer, starting at the top. From the moment we started working with Zierer, they made us feel like we were a top priority. They wanted to make sure we were happy with their designs, the different design options that they gave us to look at and the processes involved. Advantage Engineers, their confidence and knowledge for designing the foundations, structures has been reassuring, and they will continue to help guide us as we go through this project. KPI Technologies, it's Knoebel Picarelli Incorporated. They have been instrumental in bringing all the various pieces of this enormous puzzle together. Bear Wolf Architects, Rocky Bear has been developing the station design and queue line flow to meet both the needs of this ride and also the needs of this site. He is working with a design concept that actually started with one of our in-house artists, Jerry Sassani. Mike Catino. Mike is an engineer that's working with Rocky to perform engineering and structural analysis for the station design. And a big special thank you to First Columbia Bank and Trust for providing the financing necessary to see this project become a reality. So we'd like to thank everyone for joining us here this morning for this momentous occasion for this company and our family and all the families involved. You certainly will see updates of this project on our website, Facebook, Twitter feeds, and as well as other media alerts. So at this point, I guess we'll be available if anyone has any questions. Again, thank you for joining us this morning. We'll also be moving over onto the job site to do an official groundbreaking moment. Thank you.
Okay, everyone look here for a picture. On the count of three, one, two, three.
On my count of three, start digging. One, two, three.
It's too hard.
Okay.
Oh, really? You gotta throw it? All right, you ready? Dad, you count again?
All right.
One, two, three.
All right. Now maybe if we could get a picture with the Knoebel family.
Okay. All right.
Do the different groups. And Cosmo and Dexter, you guys could stay there too.
All right.
Just stand for now.
Okay.
Okay, so you gave us a little bit of a description during the ceremony. Can you give us a few more details? Start off, yeah, we've mentioned, of course, that is being Zierer is manufacturer. Can we ask what this coaster is costing?
We're not getting ready to disclose that.
Okay. This
it costs a lot of money.
Okay.
It's going to be our most expensive ride to date.
All right. And you said now that it's going to have a 98-foot vertical tower?
That's right. It'll be 98-foot. It's about where I'm standing, actually.
About where you're standing. Okay, so this here is the entrance to the park right there. So as people enter, drive in through the entrance of the park, they're actually going to have the view of the tower as they come into the park?
That's exactly right.
And this location, as you can see here, we are at where the former bumper boats were located here, right at the front of the park. So I assume that there was a reason for you choosing this location, other than the fact that the bumper boats was just...
Well, it's a signature ride, and we wanted to have a standout attraction in it, in this space, because as we before, we had the bumper boats with a very unique roof for a long time. It kind of popped your eyes as you were coming into the park, and we wanted to also have something that would pop your eyes as you enter the parking lot area. And we figured what could be better than a 98-foot, 90-degree angled tower. So yeah, we thought this would be the perfect place to put it, but also the fact that the bumper boats have pretty much seen its day, along with the boat tag, which required extensive maintenance through the season. So we're happy to move in this direction.
And what led you to this direction? People somewhat surprised by the choice of a steel coaster rather than a more traditional approach of the wind coasters like you already have?
No, I think a lot of people are actually very excited that we're getting a steel coaster. We had a steel looping coaster from 93 to 2004 called the Whirlwind, and a lot of people like that. We also had a steel coaster before that yet, the Jetstar coaster, which we got in 1977. And, you know, we had a fairly large park without a steel coaster for a long time. And a lot of people were asking for one, especially one with some inversions. And so that's what we started out on a journey about 2 years ago to find out what would be the best fit for Knoebels.
And can you give a brief description of what that journey contained? I mean, how did you come about to choosing this particular ride, this particular manufacturer?
The journey started off a couple years ago at IAPA, and we had a budget in mind, an idea of what we wanted in mind, but also a little map of where we were planning on putting a new coaster. And we went booth to booth, talking to different coaster manufacturers, and we were able to narrow it down fairly quickly from there. And we spoke with them a great deal more, and then we took a trip, Brian, Trevor, and I, along with Jim Martini, who is kind of one of the project managers here, and we visited a number of parks that have both the two manufacturers that we had narrowed it down to. and Zierer came out on top.
And the reason for them coming out on top was because of the various reasons that you've done, but primarily it was because they were able to give you exactly the package that you wanted for this location.
Well, I think they both could. Zierer came out on top a little bit because a number of factors. One, we simply liked it a bit more. Some coasters are fairly cookie cutter, and we wanted a more signature piece. And this was that, but also at the same time, they seemed a bit willing to work with us a great deal more than another manufacturer. So I think a lot of it had to do with how their coasters were scheduled. I think the one was fairly busy and didn't have enough space in their manufacturing schedule to accommodate us, whereas Zierer was fairly open.
Right, and so. Then you mentioned going to parks, and of course the one ride that most we can compare the most with this one is at Lagoon in Salt Lake City, so I assume you've been there and you've ridden that.
Yes.
What differentiates this coaster from that one?
Oh, a great deal, actually. One of the things that we liked about Lagoon was the 90-degree drop, and they put on a great ride. But what is different than ours is that we actually don't have an LSM launch like the one at Wicked does at Lagoon. This will be a traditional chain lift that will take you up, because we like that feeling of anticipation, that buildup of 20 or 30 seconds, whatever it gets to the top, before you drop down. We like that anticipation a great deal more than the thrill of a launch. At the same time, though, also the one at Lagoon had a mid-course break partway through, and we didn't want that. It seems to take away a great deal of the ride. It's like putting the curtain down during a middle of a good Shakespeare play. So we wanted to avoid a mid-course break and have it one complete ride from the top to the brake line.
Right, and then can you, now that we're here at the location, you said the tower is going to be right where we're standing here, mm-hmm. and basically in towards the middle of this thing, so can you show us a little bit more how the layout is going to be here?
Sure.
Where's the station, for example, going to be located?
The station is going to be right over here, kind of more or less between those two trees. A little bit further this way. It's going to come up around here, and it'll start going up the tower. Not far from here, it'll go up 90 degrees and down. It'll go into a cobra roll, kind of about where that first orange stake is, and then it'll come back over here. We'll do another loop right here. Come around and do an overbank turn, a little bit off, but above the station. It'll come back around. And we'll go back to the center of the tower here, and do a loop around it, and kind of an upward helix around it, I should say. And we'll then do a heartline roll through that loop, and I'll make towards another helix, another upwards helix, over off in that corner.
Mm-hmm.
And then it'll come down. I wouldn't say a steep break, but it'll be a downhill brake run.
Back into the station, right over here. All right, and then we're expecting the time frames that were given was track parts will be beginning arriving in December.
The track parts will arrive in 40 containers in December, and but we can't really open them until January. There's a team from Zierer that'll be coming over here that will assist us and direct how we should be going. They want to get a lay of the land to determine what pieces should be done first. Most likely is going to start with the tower and then start working around it for the erection process.
Right, so we could potentially see the coaster go upright in January. Is what you're expecting then, the first
vertical? Well, around the very end of January, okay. We hope to have that done. what do you have on the first pieces are put together? It's going to be put, actually, assembled on the ground first mm-hmm. from the tower, and then it'll be erected as one large tower piece.
Right. Okay, well, that gives us a good idea. So right now we've got the clearing going on. Oh, station is being done by your people here. That
yes.
So will work begin on that then sooner?
Probably. We can't start building around, you know, a roof over the area where they're going to be dropping the track in with the crane. But we can start doing some of the foundations for, of course.
Just giving the people an idea of what they can expect as they happen to come by, especially during the off season, of course, is when all this work is really going to happen. Mm-hmm. So, and then scheduled opening date of when the park opens the next season is when you expect to have the ride open as well.
That is our target date. Mm-hmm. You know, we can't guarantee that it'll mm-hmm. be open in opening weekend, but it'll certainly be open on the early part of 2015.
Okay, thank you very much for your time, Rick. Appreciate it.
Yeah, you got it. Did you have a good one?